All right, welcome back to Close Up, everyone. If he wins the Republican primary, this will be the third straight matchup against Carol Shea Porter. Frank Ginta is our next guest this morning. Good to see you. How
are
you?
Good to be back. I'm great.
You know, so there are some people out there, which I'm sure you're aware, who analyze races and do that for a living that think, you know what? He's taking this for granted. He thinks that he thinks this is going to be a walk. How do you respond?
Well, I don't take any race for granted. I think most people know that about the times that I have run. Look, I'm focused on making sure that people appreciate and understand the issues of this race. First of all, it's about the economy, balancing our budget, making sure that we give people job opportunity. But the reality is I have released over 500 endorsements across the district, have been all across the district to events and functions, making sure that people know that I'm continue to be accessible and available. And I love that campaigning process. So I'm looking forward to continue to do that. And we'll continue to release more supporters and endorsements of our effort.
Sure.
But we, of course, never take anything lightly and never look past the next election.
But is there a strategy involved when you are the front runner? I mean, because if you're out there too much, it obviously increases the risk of saying something to come back to haunt you later. So you have people in your ear saying you don't need to do this.
Well, look, the reality is there's a possibility you say something that's taken out of context or that you could have corrected or you could have said differently. That happens. We're all human. But the reality is in New Hampshire, I think it's vital to be out in the public. I think it's vital to be meeting with people because we are a state that expects that our representatives are close to the people. That's in direct contrast, I think, to what you're seeing with Carol Shea Porter. So I'm going to continue to be public and available. Happy to be, you know, doing different media events. And earlier this week, I was at Great Bay Community College talking with students and talking with the president about the opportunities that we're creating for job creation out in the Seacoast. Those things are important also for me to understand what the best way is to represent people from the state of New Hampshire.
Yeah, obviously you're in a primary with Dan Innes. He was just on the program a moment ago. His criticism, if you can call it that, has been the same throughout, and that's that, you know what, I'm a new guy, I'm an educator, a businessman. Frank Ginta is a career politician. Nothing really wrong with that, but that's where we're different. What do you say?
You know, look, New Hampshire Republican Party loves primaries, and we've got Brendan Kelly in the primary too. He's a good guy. Yeah, Dan's a good guy. Look, I'm going to get criticized. It's part of their strategy to try to criticize me and have them differentiate themselves.
Do you consider that a criticism when somebody says you're a career politician?
Well, he's trying to use it as a criticism. The reality is, you know, I served as mayor of our great city, Manchester, our state's largest city, because the city needed leadership. The city, I stepped up to do something that was critically important and passionate. And it was the same thing when I decided to run for Congress, that I did it because we had serious and legitimate issues that needed to be addressed. I think in New Hampshire, we expect people to serve. You know, we have a volunteer legislature. Most of our municipal-based elections are about volunteerism. And I think that that's it's a New Hampshire sort of rite of passage. So I know he wants to try to use it as a criticism, but people know who I am. People know that I care, that I have deep passions for our state, for our country, and that's why I've decided to run.
One more on the campaign, and then we'll move on to some of the topical issues. But what do you think of Dan Innes?
I think he's a good guy. I mean, I've met him several times. He's a good guy. He's got a right, like everybody else, to want to serve. And I applaud that willingness to serve, just like with Brendan Kelly. And we'll see what the voters say in September. I would hope that people give me the opportunity to run against Carol Shea Porter. I think I give the state and the party the best chance to beat Carol and to focus on the issues that are important to people, the economy, growing the middle class, having better job opportunities.
All right, let's talk about some of the issues that will be important, that are important now and could be in terms of the election. And let's start with the immigration situation and the kids crossing the border down south. What do we do? I mean, we're talking about children now, which obviously changes the dynamic to a certain degree, do you think?
Well, let's start with back in June of 2012, the president issued a DACA order to Homeland Security, which essentially allowed people to come over the border in terms of almost like an amnesty-like circumstance. That is what precipitated a number of people coming across the border. But it's not just the 50,000-plus children. Since April, there have been 300,000 people that have been detained at the border. I think it's because of not just the DACA order from 2012, but because the president reissued that order in April of this year. So it's now a four-year period where he is saying to people south of the border that you can come here without reprisal and without following our laws. That's wrong. That should be, he should reverse that, and Congress should act on that as well. Then with the issue of people who have just crossed over, I feel very strongly that, you know, we should be sending these people back to their countries of origins, back to their families, and then we need to work with the leaders of those countries to make sure that they're providing safe and secure and adequate security features so those families feel like they don't have to break the law in sending their children here. But that's going to require some leadership. I think you saw this week that Congress and the President seem to be getting closer in trying to find a mid-level solution, and I hope that they'll do that, get that completed in the next week or so.
Okay, let's go overseas. Obviously, Russia has been in the news for a while, Ukraine, more so lately with the downing of the aircraft. Your thoughts on the approach this administration has taken so far with Russia? Because, and I'll ask you the same question I asked Mr. Innes. Is it a fine line here, or is there a red line?
Well, let's start with, I think the best approach is what President Reagan took, peace through strength, to have, and that requires leadership from our president. And I don't think we're seeing it. I don't think people around the world are seeing it. So that sends in and of itself a message to Putin that he can get away with whatever he wants to get away with. The downed airliner appears to be directly and squarely the fault of the Russians. So far, they haven't felt any great pressure to leave the Ukraine and to try to come up with some sort of peace process for that region. So our president needs to immediately act and immediately have the European nations come to some strong position that sends a message to President Putin. And the best way to do that, because Europe is so reliant on gas from Russia, is for us to have not just energy independence, but to be able to export to Europe. So that economic issue is removed from the table, and the European countries can address Russia the way they should be able to.
Coalition building takes time. And we're not talking about a U.S. Cargo craft that was taken down. This is a commercial airliner with civilians on board, Dutch nationals mostly, some Australians, one American. Is that an immediate enough answer to try to put together a European coalition with a lot of different opinions out there to figure out a way to hit them in the pocketbook financially when it comes to energy?
Well, there's a short-term sort of solution and goals and objectives, but then there's long-term. You know, imagine if we were energy independent 5 years ago. Maybe that could have stopped this circumstance from happening today. So you always have to have a long game, and that can start today. But the short term, we have to have a unified front directing Putin to immediately remove any activity that he has in the Ukraine border. We've got to stand with Ukraine.
And if he doesn't?
He needs to do it. It needs to be done, and the European nations need to step up and act. And I think if you do that and you continue with more serious sanctions, economic sanctions, then I think he will retreat.
Okay. You brought up the idea of energy, and I want to ask your opinion on something, on whether you think this should be an issue in the 2014 election, 2016 election, as asked earlier. Should climate change be an issue when it comes to our next elected representatives for president in Congress, Senate, or is it?
Well, I think people determine, you know, in these elections what are most important to them. And when you talk to people again, they want to talk about the economy. They want to talk about jobs. They're concerned about health care. That being said, the issue of global warming or climate change, you know, continues to come up. The bottom line is the science has not been solidified on this issue. Let's see some more
scientific. What will it take to solidify the science here?
Well, I think you've got to have, first of all, the fact that a liberal Democrat says the science is solidified doesn't make it true.
Is a paper from 800 scientists good enough?
I think you've got to be honest about,
where it came from.
You got to be honest about where some of these papers are coming from, okay. The positions or you know, the political position that they have, the intent of this. I mean, you want to try to have apolitical science on these things, and that's right. Not exactly easy to obtain in a short amount of time. You know, when you walk outside, Is there change in the weather? Absolutely. We see it every day. What are the contributing factors to that? I think is still under discussion, and we can have that discussion. But let's do it in a reasonable, rational approach.
Okay. We have about 30 seconds to go. So how are you going to spend the next 6 weeks? Because time's flying here.
Well, every day is a campaign day. And I will do everything I can to meet as many voters as I possibly can and ask for their support. This is a critical election. I think from a Republican nomination standpoint, I fare the best opportunity to beat Carol Shea Porter and the best opportunity to respectfully represent the 1st Congressional District, and that's what I'll spend my time doing.
Best of luck moving forward.
Thank you.
Good to see you. I'm going to be right back.